Hello everyone. Today I'm going to be doing something a little bit different, and we're going to be looking at the founder of our Methodist movement, the Reverend John Wesley. And what we're going to do is we're going to be looking at one of his sermons today, his sermon titled Salvation by Faith. Wesley was ordained in 1728 in the Church of England, and from his leadership and through the movement that later became several expressions of Methodism, including the Methodist Church, the Wesleyan Church, the Nazarenes, etc., Wesley's influence has been felt all the way around the world. The late Dr. Kenneth Kinghorn, who is one of our mentors, writes in his book that the Oxford Dictionary of the Christian Church states simply, John Wesley was one of the greatest Christians of his age. His enduring renown was due in part to his ability articulate the Christian message in plain words. Wesley instructed those who were lay preachers at the time to start out by preaching the 52 standard sermons that he had written. And so through that preaching and through that process, they learned how to preach and how to be formed in theology and how to give the plain gospel for everybody. And so today, I thought I'd revisit some of that. I've taught Wesley's sermons for several years, and again, our friend and mentor, Dr. Kinghorn, who is with the Lord now, he took the time to painstakingly translate, if you will, Wesley's sermons from the 18th century English it was written in to the 20th century version that I have in my possession. If you're ever interested in looking at Wesley and learning more about these sermons and their wonderful way to help you grow in your faith, this is the book that I'm using. It's the Standard Sermons in Modern English. And again, the author is Dr. Kenneth Kinghorn. And you can find these on Amazon and I'm sure various other places. So if you'll bow your heads with me and let's dig into Wesley today. Let's pray together. Amazing God, thank you so much for your servant, Mr. Wesley. And thank you for the fact that you have formed millions of us through his influence and taught us how to live lives as Christians and to live them fully with you. Please use these words that he has written and instruct us all today so that we can grow closer and closer to Christ and we can continue in our journey onward to perfection. For eternity is ours because of your mercy, Jesus. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The first sermon that Wesley has in his 52 standard that Dr. Kinghorn has translated for us is Salvation by Faith. And so the key verse here is Ephesians 2, verse 8, which reads, "By grace you have been saved through faith." Wesley writes, "All the blessings that God has bestowed upon humankind come entirely from his grace. These blessings flow from his generous and undeserved favor, and we have no rightful claim to the least of his mercies. God, in his grace, formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. It was God who stamped on our souls his own image and put all things under our feet. God's free grace continues with us and gives us life and breath and all things. There is nothing that we are or have or do that deserves God's smallest blessings. As Isaiah declares, all that we have done, you have done for us. All the things we are and have come and have come as gifts of God's free mercy, and any righteousness we may have is likewise the gift of God." So you see in the very beginning, Wesley sets out and says, let's get this right from the very start. All the blessings that God has bestowed upon humankind came entirely from his grace. These blessings flow from his generous, undeserved favor, and we have no rightful claim to the least of his mercies. In other words, Wesley is setting the stage to say, don't think that you're the one who has given yourself anything. Instead, realize that everything comes from God. And so by doing that, Wesley right-sizes us. He says, we are not God, God is God, and therefore we start in the place of reminding ourselves that everything, all mercies, all grace come from God. Mr. Wesley continues, by what means can we sinful people atone for even the least of our sins? That's a good question. Have you thought about that? By what means can we as a sinful people atone for even the least of our sins? Wesley continues, with good works? No. Even if we have performed numerous good works, none of them are our own. They are God's who made them possible. I'm reminded of people who sometimes tell me, I'm a good person. I do this, I do that. And usually it's in a conversation where they're explaining to me why they don't need Christ. I have to tell you, Wesley is good at reminding us that good works don't cut it. That's not what this is about. And he reminds us right here that even if we have performed numerous good works, none of them are our own. They are God's who made them possible. He continues, in truth, even our so-called good works are unholy and sinful. What? Yeah. Going forward, Wesley continues, they need atonement because a corrupt tree can produce only corrupt fruit. Our hearts are altogether corrupt and reprehensible because all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We have failed to retain the glorious righteousness originally impressed on the soul, patterned after the image of the great Creator. Therefore, because we cannot claim our own righteousness or good works, we have nothing with which to atone for our sins. Let every mouth be silenced and the whole world be accountable, held accountable to God. Right there, that's going to strike a nerve with many of us. And I even find myself wincing at that a little bit. You mean that all of my good works, my supposed good works that I'm even proud of, those two are sinful? And Wesley is saying, yeah, they are. Because the tree, the corrupt tree, cannot produce good fruit. In other words, even when we think that we're operating out of our best of motivations, we still fall short. So therefore, Wesley reasons, we cannot count on even our so-called good works to mean anything for our salvation. If we, sinful people, find favor with God, it is only from the fullness of His grace that we receive blessing after blessing. If God favors us by pouring fresh blessings upon us, yes, the greatest of all blessings, which is salvation, we can only say, thanks be unto God for His indescribable gift. And so, it is that God demonstrated His love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Grace is the source and faith, the condition of our salvation. If we are to benefit from the grace of God, we need carefully to inquire into, first, the nature of the faith by which we are saved, second, the nature of the salvation that comes through faith, and third, the answers to some objections. I like this because Wesley always presents what he's going to talk about in his sermon, and then towards the end sometimes he'll say, and we'll answer some objections, we'll answer some questions that you may have after hearing this. So he sets it up, and he reminds us that everything is from God. While we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. This means then, Wesley is saying, let's start correctly. Let's get ourselves mindful of the fact that there is nothing within us inherently that can save us. Nothing. If you look deeply inside your heart, and I look deeply inside mine, I know this to be true. We need God. And we cannot begin to believe, if we're truly honest, that anything that comes out of our own heart is perfect and good. Only God is. And Wesley reminds us of this as we move forward. Part one, the faith by which we are saved. Saving faith is not the same as the faith of heathen, those who do not worship the God of the Bible. God requires all people to believe that without faith, it is impossible to please God, for whoever would approach him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. He's indirectly quoting Hebrews here. God expects us all to give thanks for everything and to practice moral virtue, justice, mercy, and truth toward our fellow human beings. Spiritually unenlightened Greeks, Romans, Scythians, and Indians were without excuse if their faith did not lead them at least this far. God expected them to believe in the being and attributes of God, a future state of rewards or punishments, and the necessity of moral virtue. Those completely outside the knowledge of God are expected to have this minimum level of faith. So in other words, Wesley is saying that simply believing that there is a God and that someday you will be held accountable and that you have to practice a basic moral virtue, he said that's really nothing to brag about. In fact, it's expected of you. In fact, he says that because it's actually planted within you that there is God and no human being is with excuse because no one has been born on the planet who hasn't had the absolute knowledge that there is someone higher, that there is a God planted inside of who they are. Wesley calls this a basic faith even of the heathen. And so what he's saying is those completely outside the knowledge of God are expected to have this minimal level of faith. So if you think about it for a second, if you'll do any kind of research, you'll find that even today, roughly 80% of all people who are living in this country believe that there is some kind of a spiritual realm. They would term themselves as spiritual beings. And for many, this is kind of satisfying. They feel like, well, I've done my bit. I've believed there's something out there, maybe a higher power, and that's good enough. Wesley says, well, don't be fooled. That's good that you believe that, but the reality is that that's just basically being a human. You can't take credit for that. God placed within you the knowledge that there's somebody bigger than you. There is a God, and he's outside of you, and he is apart from you, and he is, you know, not you. And so Wesley then is saying that just being a spiritual person, that's just like a baseline. That's not anything to brag about or to see as an achievement. And so he's telling us that just having spiritual feelings, it's not enough. It's a starting place, but that's not the end of the journey. Saving faith, he continues, is not merely the intellectual knowledge held by demons. The faith of demons is only a mental belief in God, although a demon's faith exceeds the faith of those who do not know God. The devil himself believes that there is a wise and powerful God who is gracious to reward and just to punish. In addition, the devil knows that Jesus is the Son of God, the Christ, and the Savior of the world. Thus, in the Gospel of Luke, we find a demon expressly declaring to Jesus, "I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Moreover, we do not doubt that this demon acknowledged the truth of all the words that Jesus spoke. It believed, even those things that were written by God's righteous people. It was an evil spirit who confessed that Paul and Silas were slaves of the Most High God who proclaimed the way of salvation. All the demons, those arch enemies of God, believe these things and they tremble in the presence of Jesus Christ. They know that God was revealed in the flesh, that he will put all his enemies under his feet, and that all scripture is inspired by God. The faith of a demon acknowledges all these truths. Well, that's quite a thing to think about. Because if you look at the scriptures, you see Wesley is exactly right. If you think about the scene of the Gerasene demoniac, whenever Jesus hits the shore of that particular part of the world and the man comes out from the tombs who has been tortured, and Jesus asks his name, and he says, "My name is Legion, for we are many." The thing that he is saying to Jesus as he walks towards him is, "Have you come to torture us. We know who you are, the Holy One of God. In other words, simply knowing that Jesus is real, knowing that he is the Son of God, knowing that God will judge, knowing that God is righteous, knowing that God will call to account all that has happened since the beginning of time. Simply knowing that, Wesley says, it's not saving faith. It's the faith that the demons have. So we really can't pat ourselves on the back for acknowledging that God is God, or even that Jesus Christ is his Son. That's simple and basic. Even the demons know it. Third, saving faith is not the faith that the apostles had prior to the resurrection of Christ. Listen to this point. The apostles had faith in Christ while he was still on earth. They trusted him to such an extent that Peter said, "We have left everything and followed you." The apostles even had faith to work miracles to heal every disease and sickness. Indeed, they had power and authority over all demons. Furthermore, their master even sent them out to proclaim the kingdom of God. So what Wesley is saying here is, before Jesus goes to the cross, is crucified, dies, and is buried, and then the resurrection occurs, before all that happens, the faith that even the apostles had who hung out with Jesus is not a saving faith. In other words, yes, they hung out with Jesus. Yes, they knew him. Yes, they followed him for 3.5 years. But that is not a saving faith. That's merely knowing Jesus. But the work of the cross and the resurrection, Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, not because we were mean or because God is cruel, but he died for our sins. It hadn't happened yet. And so therefore, just being friends of Jesus, if you will, and they were, that's not saving faith. What then, this is number 4 in his first part, what then is saving faith? To begin with, we may answer this question in general by saying that saving faith is trust in Christ. I've highlighted it in my book. If you ever choose to buy this book, I would suggest you would highlight it too. But I'll highlight it for you mentally now. Saving faith is trust in Christ. Christ and God the Father through Christ are the proper objects of saving faith. This faith is properly and completely distinguished from the faith of ancient or modern persons who did not know the true God. Saving faith differs from the faith of a devil. Saving faith is not merely a speculative, rational thing, a cold, lifeless assent, or a train of ideas in the head. It is primarily a disposition of the heart. Scripture declares, if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So then again, Wesley is saying it's trust in Christ and it's a disposition of the heart, not merely a speculative, rational, cold, lifeless assent or a train of ideas in the head, he writes. It is primarily a disposition of the heart. In other words, you're not saved through advanced intellectualism concerning Jesus. You're saved because your heart turns to him and trusts him with all that you are. Fifth, by confessing Christ in this way, saving faith differs from the kind of faith that the apostles had while our Lord was still on earth. Saving faith understands the necessity of Christ's death, its merit, and the power of his resurrection. Let me say that again. Saving faith understands the necessity of Christ's death, its merit, and the power of his resurrection. This faith acknowledges the death of Jesus as the only satisfactory means of redeeming humankind from everlasting death. It confesses Christ's resurrection as the restoration of us all to life and immortality. For Christ was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. Thus, Christian faith is more than an intellectual assent to the entire gospel of Christ. It also means a complete reliance on the blood of Christ. It is full trust in the merits of his life, death, and resurrection. Saving faith is a resting upon Christ as our atonement and our life, a Savior who gave himself for us and lives in us. The result of saving faith is uniting with Christ and adhering firmly to him who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. In a word, Christ is our salvation. So when we look at this final paragraph that he writes in part one, we realize that saving faith is not intellectual assent to merely that Christ is Christ or even the gospel of Christ. You can even say, hey, I really believe this is all a really good idea. I hope my neighbor's hearing this. That's not what it's about. Rather, it is a complete reliance on the blood of Christ. It is full trust in the merits of his life, death, and resurrection. This is vitally important, Christians, because so many these days want to skip past the cross and enjoy the fruit of the resurrection. But we simply cannot do that. The cross had to happen. Sin is deadly. There has to be a penalty paid. God is righteous. Justice is of God. And yet God did not want to abandon us to the abyss, and so that's why Christ came. The penalty must be paid for sin, and that is what Christ did on the cross through his death. Sin's that serious. But the good news is that the resurrection comes, and that those who trust in him may be raised with him and need not fear. But take this point with you, and we will draw to a close for today. Saving faith is a complete reliance on the blood of Christ. It is full trust in the merits of his life, death, and resurrection. It is resting upon Christ as our atonement and our life. The result of saving faith is uniting with Christ. If you're uncomfortable with the idea that sin kills, that it leads to death, and that Christ had to die, and you want to just walk over that part and go to the joy of resurrection, you'll never know that joy. It won't come. Because part of saving faith is realizing in your deepest being that you need a Savior. There is no other way. Your sin is that serious. So is mine. But the good news is we have a merciful God who has come to save us, and that's what we talk about when we read about and think about and speak about and meditate on salvation by faith. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.